The advice, counseling, and opinions expressed in the following program represent the views of the program participants and do not necessarily represent the views of Multnomah Community Television.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Cosmic Connection live, February 10th, 2002. I am your host, the Cosmic Connector. And in studio today with me again today is Mr. Eric Beiler. Eric, welcome to the Cosmic Connection. Welcome to be in studio today, pal.
And thank you for inviting me.
Yeah, always a pleasure. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Eric Beiler is the Assistant Director of the Oregon UFO Research Organization. He is at OregonUFOReview.com. His expertise and his vast staff of helpers and investigators into this unusual phenomenon of the UFO lenticular aerodynes. He's always out there in the field. As you may have known, a couple of shows back, he brought us in the Brenda Ruiz video. We've got a lot on topic today, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to have a Roswell tour. We're going to have a new Area 51 photo. Eric, I think last time we saw a photo of any kind from Area 51 was back in 89, 90, I believe mm-hmm. it was, when they took Freedom Ridge away. Mm-hmm. And they had some shots of the area, of Area 51. So we're going to show a new Area 51 aerial photo by Mr. William Schreier. Next, going to cover the Exeter in New Hampshire. Some new sightings have been happening out in New Hampshire. And as you may or may not know, one of the most world-famous sightings happened in Exeter, witnessed by a police officer and other individuals of the area. We'll also be covering the 60th anniversary of the Battle over Los Angeles. That was February 26, 1942. Other news, we have Mexico sightings again. The OVNIs are back, Eric.
Excellent.
Yes, it is, and we hope to get some video footage from that. And we're also going to show the Brenda Ruiz video again. I think that'd be a good treat for our viewers out there. Also want to let you know that Clyde Lewis of Ground Zero on KOTK 1080 will be on again Sunday night tonight. And I think he comes on around 8 or 9 o'clock. Check your listings for KOTK 1080. That's Sunday night tonight, ladies and gentlemen, the Clyde Lewis Ground Zero. We give him props for getting his program on the air and doing a great show with this phenomenon of the ufology that we cover. Okay, let's start off the show, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you have your VCR tapes running, because my director, Frank, of FM Images, Bi-Wheeled Aerodynes, he has a website out there you can go to. Frank, my director, is just back from assignment after 1 week. 1 week ago, he was in Roswell, New Mexico, took a little tour of the Roswell International Museum, I think it is. It's the Roswell Museum in Roswell, New Mexico, and we're going to have a Roswell tour. We've got the book. Mr. Don Schmidt is going to take us on the tour of the Roswell Museum, and he is the co-author of The Truth About the UFO Crash at Roswell. He is co-author with Kevin D. Randall and Donald R. Schmidt. Don Schmidt is going to take us on about a 28-minute tour. This is very, very interesting stuff. Going to take you back into the heyday, the 40s and 50s. We're going to have some great music. Also want to let you know that the Cosmic Connection best of programs can be viewed at extranettv.com. That's our flagship station for the internet. So you folks out there with internet capability, go to extranettv.com. You can view the Cosmic Connection. Also, our new web address is ufotvshow@hotmail.com. Seems a lot of you were getting misguided with the underscore, so I changed everything completely and just made it really easy for you people out there. It is ufotvshow@hotmail.com. Our new website, I try and update it every other day. It's at http://click2UFOTV. That is click, C-L-I-K dot T-O /UFOTV. There it is on your screen as it magically appears. Again, we're going to show a video of the Roswell tour that our director Frank took. He has at FM Images bi-wheeled Aerodyne. So for you racing enthusiasts out there who are into off-road racing, the PIR activities, he's done some very good video footage of in action with Jeeps flying around, off-road, what have you. Frank's been in the filming of off-road racing for many, many years, and I think we're going to go into the Roswell video right now. So this is to get you up to date. If you don't know about the Roswell crash, and I really don't think there's too many people out there, Eric, that don't know about Roswell, but maybe you haven't been able to travel to Roswell, New Mexico, so we're going to take you on a Roswell tour with co-author of The Truth About the UFO Crash at Roswell, Mr. Don Schmidt. So we can take it away.
Welcome to the International UFO Museum and Research Center. We're standing in the opening doorway, and we're just about to enter, and we'll take a video tour of exactly what the museum has on display. Here we are at the main entrance where people come in, they register, and then can actually require videotapes and sound tapes as far as their tour as they go through the museum. So we'll proceed from here. This would be our first display as far as the time actually preceding the Roswell incident itself, beginning with the Kenneth Arnold sighting, some of the original newspaper accounts, some of our actual model displays that have been donated to the museum through the years. You'll be seeing more and more of those as we tour through the museum. And then events leading up to the museum itself. Where we'll be going next will be starting with the history of the base itself, Roswell Army Airfield, which would become Walker Air Force Base in 1948. So as you can see, even aerial photographs of the base itself dating right back to 1947, shots of even bombing raids during the ending of World War II, the Enola Gay, the very first B-29 that dropped the first atomic bomb in Hiroshima, which was hangared here at Roswell at one time. Also, General Chuck Sweeney's flying boxcar, which was the second atomic bomb plane, which also was also hangared here after the war. So then some actual shots of some of the A-bomb tests, and then we'll just let you go from shot to shot. They're self-explanatory. Even General Ramey, certainly important regarding the Roswell incident itself. Shots of the public information officer and Lieutenant Walter Hott, famous for the press release, the base commander, Colonel William Blanchard. and just the photographic history of the 509th, we felt it was important to demonstrate that you had the elite within the military at that time. The 509th was a composite bomb group where they selected the best pilots, the best crewmen, the best officers, and placed them all in this one unit. And they were responsible for the atomic bomb. So we want the people to understand the background, the history, the experience and training of the military personnel who within a matter of 2 years become involved with what we believe to be the most significant, most historic event of the millennium, the Roswell UFO crash of 1947. With our first display panel here, we start out with, again, a background, but of the outlying area, the ranch area, involving ranch supervisor Mac Brazel and the events of that very evening when this object of unknown origin would crash about 75 miles northwest of Roswell, New Mexico. We have pictures of some of the relevant buildings which would be later involved with the incident, pictures of some of the people involved, even up to the $3,000 reward, which at that time played a part in why Brazel was encouraged to report the find here in Roswell. A map of the overview of the debris field site as identified by numerous independent sources, and then the alleged impact site, which in our investigation still remains somewhat fluid. We are still trying to pin it down precisely. But there's been a lot of disinformation over these past 10 years regarding its precise location. So as I said, it is still something very fluid. And then going up the chain of events leading up to Brazel, reporting the find to Sheriff George Wilcox at the Chavez County Sheriff's Department, and then radio reporter Frank Joyce placing the call, speaking with Brazel about the find, and also encouraging him to report it to the Roswell Army Airfield. And here, one of our more famous displays, an actual replica of KGFL, the very radio station that was responsible for first breaking the story and who later would interview Brazel when he would retract that original flying saucer crash. In fact, if, and I hope it works, it's a little touchy, but if it works, as it should, you should hear an actual ABC radio broadcast announcing the capture of the flying saucer at that time.
The American Broadcasting Company and affiliated stations present Headline Edition with Taylor Grant. Today's edition presents a roundup of the latest developments in the finding of a flying disc.
Late this afternoon, a bulletin from New Mexico suggested that the widely publicized mystery of the flying saucers may soon be solved. Army Air Force officers reported that one of the strange discs had been found and inspected sometime last week. Our correspondents in Los Angeles and Chicago have been in contact with Army officials endeavoring to obtain all possible late information. Joe Wilson reports to us now from Chicago. The Army may be getting to the bottom of all this talk about the so-called flying saucers. As a matter of fact, the 509th Atomic Bomb Group headquarters at Roswell, New Mexico, reports that it has received one of the discs which landed on a ranch outside Roswell. The disc landed at a ranch at Corona, New Mexico, and the rancher turned it over to the Air Force. Rancher W.W. Brazel was the man who discovered the saucer. Colonel William Blanchard of the Roswell Air Base refuses to give details of what the flying disc looks like. In Fort Worth, Texas, where the object was first sent, Brigadier General Roger Ramey says that it is being shipped by air to the AAF Research Center at Wright Field, Ohio. A few moments ago, I talked to officials at Wright Field, and they declared that they expect the so-called flying saucer to be delivered there, but that it hasn't arrived as yet.
I wanted to point one last thing out, even here at the teletype machine. This is an actual teletype that was found in the records of KGFL. pertaining to the crash of the flying saucer. As you can see, it contains that very press release that would come out at noon Central Standard Time on Tuesday, July 8th. The many rumors regarding a flying disc became a reality yesterday when the intelligence office of the 509th Bomb Group of the 8th Air Force, Roswell Army Airfield, was fortunate enough to gain possession of a disc through the cooperation of one of the local ranchers and the sheriff's office of Chavez County. The flying object landed on a ranch near Roswell sometime last week. Not having phone facilities, the rancher stored the disc until such time as he was able to contact the sheriff's office, who in turn notified Major Jesse E. Marcel of the 509th Bomb Group Intelligence Office. Action was immediately taken, and the disc was picked up at the rancher's home. It was inspected and subsequently loaned by Major Marcel to higher headquarters. So a copy of that actual press release once it hit the wires. As we continue through the timeline of events, still that very afternoon of July 8th, and for all of the flying disc reports that were flooding the nation at that time, you can see just by the sampling here of the headlines that clearly something was invading our airspace. And people from all over the country were clamming for answers, wanted to know whose hardware, what aircraft, what was flying through the skies of the United States, and why was the military continuing to deny that they were ours, they were the Soviets, and more speculation as to the possibility we may be dealing with something off the planet. So continuing on July 8th, here the classic example of that very newspaper headline, Roswell Army Airfield captures flying saucer on ranch in Roswell region. Another copy of the press release above that, another example from Chicago Daily News, Army finds air saucer on ranch in New Mexico. And here, Spokane Daily Chronicle, for example, Spokane, Washington, Army declares flying disc found, so that a little more relevant to your area as we speak. And then continuing, and then the classic pictures as the material is then shipped from Roswell, going up the chain of command to the 8th Air Force at Carswell Army Airfield in Fort Worth, Texas, and what we believe to be the substituted material. As even Major Marcel described, how upon returning back to General Ramey's office from a map room, the genuine material, the real material, was gone, and in its place was a radar reflector kite, the crumbled remains of this hexagonal radar dish, comprised of nothing more than very flimsy, very frail reflective foil, wooden sticks, baling twine, and masking tape. Hardly the material that any trained personnel, or for that matter, even a young child, would recognize immediately for being something very conventional, very prosaic. And that is one position that we still have, that the Air Force, in its attempt to continually stall for time, fails to address. How could the most highly trained unit within the military at that time mistake the very balloons that they were launching twice a day from here in Roswell atop the bank building, the highest building here in town, for their daily atomic bomb test drops, and would make such an outlandish mistake of misidentifying something again that is that conventional? Now, one of the key people who was involved and who happens to be in two of the pictures is the late Brigadier General Thomas Jefferson DeBose. And as DeBose, in a sworn affidavit and a video statement, swore to us that it was a cover story, as you can read, that they were the ones who substituted the balloon for the real material. And that coming from a Brigadier General who was there at the time, contained within the pictures. So then, as the headlines broke that it wasn't a flying saucer, nothing more than a weather balloon, things quickly quieted down. people were relieved to hear that it wasn't anything more than a weather balloon, and few people questioning why the very people responsible for the atomic bomb would make such an outlandish mistake. But yet things continued to happen. The recovery efforts still continued out at the debris field site, at the impact site. Materials would then be transited and flown on to Wright Field, for example. There's a shot of Hangar 84, where all witnesses involved have described the bodies and material being stored before they were shipped out. We have, for example, the Glenn Dennis story, and who we believe was the nurse involved, and Glenn being the mortician who was at the Ballard Funeral Home at that time, and receiving the phone calls from the mortuary officer at the base hospital, inquiring about bodies exposed to the elements for days and the availability of smaller caskets, and then his supposed encounter with a base hospital nurse who would describe to him the bodies that she would make a sketch of and describe to him in rather gruesome detail. And continuing beyond there, we would have again layouts of the base hospital at that time, specific location of where the hangar was in relationship to other buildings on the base, statements from pilots who were involved. Pappy Henderson, Captain Pappy Henderson, very famous for his account of flying bodies out from the base here at Roswell. Captain Fred Ewing, who also was another pilot involved with a flight a couple of days later, supposedly also involving more remains, and specifically remains of bodies flown out from the base. One of our better displays, physical model displays of the actual I-beams described and the metal-like material, metal plastic-like material. Symbology on the I-beams, as described by numerous witnesses. Examples of sworn statements, affidavits, as part of the continuing demonstration that even after the balloon explanation, that's much was still happening out at the sites involved, and the base here at Roswell and Fort Worth and Wright Field. And again, the testimony of those who, even after all these years, still swear that something highly unusual took place. So we'll continue on to the next display area. As you're starting to see, we have these different cubicle areas where you can walk in and out, and just as laid out in any type of museum, that you're able to follow the sequence of events in a specific timeline. I'll quickly point out that even off to this next room over here is a video room, and I'm going to be a little bit more quiet, but where we have different times, different airing times of different documentaries. The Roswell movie, for example, which was based on the first book that Kevin Randall and I did, UFO Crash at Roswell, will show here at different scheduled times. And where people, as they come through the museum, can also at their leisure sit down and watch an entire documentary or just take in a few moments. But again, to capture the whole attempt on our part for public education, public information, and overall to let the people decide for themselves. And here off to this display area, we have the infamous MJ-12 documents, still highly controversial, but again, allowing the people to see examples of alleged documents pertaining to the incident and giving them once again a chance to decide for themselves. And also depicting as far as specific people named in the documents. In other words, faces behind all the names. And then as we come to the next display area, we get into the very cover-up itself, starting with the Project Mogul cover-up as demonstrated in September of 1994 at a press conference by the Pentagon as the Air Force released their expansive new theory, and I emphasize the word theory, as to what actually crashed outside of Roswell in 1947. And then other documents and examples of documents that have been proven to be rather dubious, even hoaxes at times, and questioning who is the source, who is responsible for the continuing attempts at disinformation. And then certainly one of the more popular displays here, as we have accepted him by the name of Harold, comes from Alderson Labs from 1952 through the late 1960s. This would serve as the Air Force's fourth explanation, which came out in June of 1997, just prior to the 50th anniversary, suggesting that this would account for all the bodies. This, to us, was a major victory, because for the first time, the Air Force would actually concede some semblance of bodies recovered. They were addressing the fact that we had first-hand witnesses to the bodies. The problem is, as you see, the project wouldn't originate till 1952, 5 years after the crash. And how they can tie the two when they're 5 years separated, again, is beyond human comprehension. But again, another example. In their attempts to stall for time, and I will continue to use that phrase, as the remaining witnesses pass on. But again, we allow the visitors here to the museum to see for themselves, and to see, is this the very thing that people would conclude was something from off the planet? If this was somehow some crew member from the object that crashed north of town here in 1947. And then as we continue as far as, for example, we have an actual directory of all the crash dummy schedule drops, and even here from 1954 till 1959, demonstrating the frequency and how often such crash dummies would have been visible, would have been even available to the lay people, the ranchers surrounding this area, and how familiar they would have been. But again, always emphasizing that this is 5 years after the fact. There was no such project back in 1947. So, and we'll continue. As an example of our continuing research, we have successfully been able to get a drum scan of the original negative of what we believe to be a smoking gun regarding the famous Ramey memo, that telex that General Ramey is holding. We were the first to actually observe back in 1990 that one could see the actual print on the telex. And as computer programming has improved over these past 12 years, we've been able to go back to it more and more with an attempt to actually computer enhance the picture. So with the help of some of our scientific colleagues, we've been able to read up to 85% of that telex. And it clearly is once again talking about the recovery of a disc, of the victims of the wreck, the multiple sites, the very object, the disc itself being shipped out, and the other necessary activities required to contain, cover up the incident, basically. And even the suggestion that weather balloons would make which we believe the continuing line would read, obviously make a good cover story. So we believe this to be one of our smoking guns. The work will continue on it, but again, as part of the museum, just a demonstration that this is a continuing investigation on our part.
Very nice, Frank. Nice work. Outstanding. We'd like to thank my director, Frank, for filming that in Roswell. Love the music. What'd you think of that, Eric?
Oh, what a neat trip.
Yeah. Very nice.
That's a trip I wanted to take one of these days.
What we're looking at now, ladies and gentlemen, is the new Area 51 photo by Mr. William Schreier. He took this a couple of months ago. He specializes in aerial photography. He states that he is the finest in aerial golf landscaping photography. That's SkyDancerLE.com, Mr. William Schreier out of California. He took this a couple of months ago. He specializes in aerial photography, especially famous golf courses. He is a private pilot, I understand, and he states, he tried to get closer to Area 51, but they wouldn't let me, he states. I even asked the non-com on the radio if this was Area 51. The reply was, He told me he had never heard of that name and that I was 50 feet too close. The shot was taken with a 6x7 medium format camera. This is a very clear photo, ladies and gentlemen, of Area 51. You can see the Groom Dry Lake in the background. There is a runway on there. It cannot be seen through this photograph. It is 7 miles long, one of the longest runways. It is the longest runway on the planet, from what I understand. And the road there at the bottom, I believe that would be part of Mailbox Road. So we'd like to thank Mr. William Schreier of his Aerial Golf Landscaping Company, and he is at skydancerle.com. This photograph is on our website, ladies and gentlemen, the new Cosmic Connection website. The new address for you viewers out there is at click.to/UFOTV, no W's. There it is. We made it real simple for you. Also, we'd like to thank Mr. Don Schmidt for giving us that great interview. We'd like to thank him. Eric, you're friends with Don Schmidt.
Actually, no. He's not one of our...
He's part of your research?
No,
he's not. Okay. He did stay to say hello to everybody up here, I believe.
I was going to note about this picture here, from what I read of this area. This is probably one of the best areas in all of the state where something like this could go on. From what I understand, this entire area of Area 51 is completely surrounded by a rim of mountains. So there's really no way to really get in there without being detected.
That is for sure. I've been to Area 51, as you well know. Dennis, a co-host, has been to Area 51 also, and has friends, and we've shown the Area 51 road trip. You can see it on extranettv.com on one of our past programs. Ladies and gentlemen, for you computers out there, you can go to extranettv.com, find our Cosmic Connection banner, click that on, and go watch my past sighting from 1987 in Las Vegas, Nevada. You can see the Stanton Friedman interview that we had. I believe David Jacobs is on there. We have the interviews. We have our book review shows on there. We've got a lot of things on extranettv.com, and that's our flagship station that has elected to broadcast past programs of the Cosmic Connection. Eric, I understand you have some sighting news from the state of Oregon.
I have a couple sightings here I want to talk about for a second. Also, I was going to mention for everybody to kind of keep their eyes and ears open for some events that are happening this summer that's kind of interesting. There's no specific dates yet, but I know this summer in McMinnville, there's going to be another large gathering going on right there in town at the famous McMinniman's Hotel. There's going to, I know 2 years ago we had Bruce McAbee was over there speaking about the...
About the
Trent photo, correct. And it's kind of grown from there. This year they're talking about having a large parade and bringing in some other guest speakers. I'm going to be there to talk about Oregon UFO sightings. And You'll be there. That'll be a really fun day.
Frank will bring his camera. Maybe we'll get an interview with some guest speakers for the show for the folks who can't make it out there.
And also, as a lot of you probably already know, as you've seen the previews, there's a film coming out here fairly quickly by the man who wrote and made the film The Sixth Sense and Unbreakable, starring Mel Gibson. It's called Signs, and I understand it's a very well-done movie. They've kind of kept it under wraps about a lot of the details, but apparently he does take it fairly seriously in that there's supernatural-type forces that are being done. So, yeah, it should be pretty good. Sightings. We've got a few sightings I want to talk about. There's four of them so far this year. Starting back on the 9th, January 9th, we had one in Springfield. We got a mother and a son from Springfield who reported to Oregon UFO Research seeing a UFO from their car. The boy was actually the first one to notice the object. Looked over and asked his mom, said, "What's this? What's that, Mom?" And she said, "Well, I'm not sure, son, but I've never seen anything like it." What she was quoted as saying. As they drove directly beneath the object, which was said to have hovered at about 600 yards overhead, they could clearly make out a craft of some sort, which was described as being like a huge upside-down black raindrop with windows containing bright white lights inside of it. That was a fairly interesting sighting. We did contact the woman, and she had agreed to let us come out and do an interview with her in person to see see if we can figure out exactly where this took place. Unfortunately, they've had some pretty bad weather over there recently, and they, as of today, they just got their lights back on in Eugene because of that big storm that came through. So we haven't been able to do that yet. On the 14th, we had a sighting from Portland. This sighting describes two triangular sets of red lights. They appeared to be at around 1,500 to 2,000 feet overhead. This report had a very deep, almost subharmonic vibration, as reported by the witness as the lights went overhead. There was no audible sound to this. They flew directly over the witness while outside on his cell phone to a friend. As the two talked, the lights increased their speed, traveling in a northbound direction. At the same time, the lights seemed to separate and form a straight line or column, and then they just shot off into the horizon. Our most recent sighting was on the 16th. We received a report from a man who lives in the southwest hills of Portland. This witness was out walking his dog heading east down the street that he lives at about 10.05 p.m. when, looking across the southeast part of Portland towards Mount Hood, noticed a red, fuzzy ball of light streaking across in front of the mountain. At first, the witness thought it was a fighter jet or a helicopter until it stopped in midair. Witness said he was dumbfounded, stopping in his tracks to watch this. It was reported that it sat in the same place for approximately 2 minutes, and then all of a sudden streaked across the sky heading to the southwest, gaining altitude at an amazing rate. He said it had no exhaust trail or light trail, and it made no noise. He was also quoted as saying that, "I have witnessed military jet fighters powering up to break the sound barrier, and this was moving much faster than that." This photograph here.
Yes, this photograph, Eric. And Eric, thanks for that report. Ladies and gentlemen, that's Mr. Eric Beiler of the
UFO research.
Great. What are we looking at here? Is it upside down?
Actually, it's upside down.
Okay.
Yeah, this is an interesting...
Can you go ahead and flip that around?
Yeah. This is an interesting picture from 1995, actually, that took place near Pensacola, Florida. I know a lot of people have heard of the famous Gulf Breeze UFO flap. This was about 4 or 5 years later. There was actually two photographs taken. One was taken of just the object, and at the time you could see the jet entering its airspace from the far left. The photographer went ahead and waited until the jet approached the UFO. It came within a very close range of the UFO. He took this picture, which is a fascinating picture because we have an overlap going on here between the jet and the UFO. As it went ahead and passed the UFO, he was going to take one more picture of it as it left the airspace. He raised his camera to take the picture, and then the UFO shot off and completely disappeared.
I see the plane.
Yeah. So the one on the top there,
yes,
you see, is a jet fighter cruising very closely to the UFO just to the left of it there.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah. So.
And that's from 1995?
That was from 1995.
What area?
That was near Pensacola, Florida.
Outstanding.
So, and then he said that the UFO that you see there to the left, it shot off at such a rate it was, you could hardly even follow it with the eyes. And I think that's another good example. A lot of people will express how that the UFO seemed to blink out or disappear. And a lot of times I think these crafts just have the ability to leave at such a rapid pace that your eyes just can't follow it, and it seems like it may just disappear.
Sure. Let's go to the 60th anniversary, ladies and gentlemen, the Battle of Los Angeles, 1942. It's the mystery air raid. On December 7th, 1941, the Japanese Navy bombed the United States Naval Base at Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, and the United States officially entered World War II. Within days, a top-secret device called radar began picking up signals thought to be those of enemy aircraft up and down the western coast of North America. Blackouts were ordered on several occasions of the various coastal cities. On February 25th, 1942, a Japanese submarine surfaced and fired on an oil field near Santa Barbara, California. The following night, February 26th, 1942, 2 million people watched as anti-aircraft batteries fired 1,400 anti-aircraft shells at a slow-moving, unidentified object in the night skies above Los Angeles. In August of 1945, the United States detonated a nuclear bomb over Hiroshima and a second bomb over Nagasaki, forcing Japan to end the war and ushering in the nuclear age. In June of 1947, Kenneth Arnold, while flying his plane across Washington State, made his historic daytime sighting of what he called flying saucers. 1 month later, the infamous Roswell crash is said to have occurred in New Mexico. there's a lot of speculation about this Battle of Los Angeles. It really did happen. There were many, several people were killed, ladies and gentlemen. Three by heart attacks, another three by falling debris from the shells. As I understand it, these shells that did not detonate actually landed in the streets in and around Long Beach, California. I used to live near Long Beach, Signal Hill area. And these bombs that didn't detonate or contact whatever it was that they were shooting at came down and broke concrete, destroyed streets, what have you, and hit some innocent civilians. One story I remember hearing was of a family where one of these shells actually landed into their house.
Wow.
So yeah, so it's amazing. This is the 60th anniversary of the Battle of Los Angeles, and that occurred on February 26, 1942. Ladies and gentlemen, if you'd like to contact the Cosmic Connection, we have our email address. Made it real simple for you out there, ladies and gentlemen. UFOTVshow@hotmail.com. It just can't get any easier than that. Eric, anything you want to bring up on the program here in the waning minutes of the Cosmic Connection?
I was going to mention that there is a possibility that we may be on the Jeff Rentz radio program here in the near future. I know some of you have heard of the situation with the Jack and Jill case that we have here involving a woman that we've had with our file now, going back to 1989. I believe I've talked Jill into actually coming on the radio program. She's been very shy about these sort of things in the past, and I'm working on her for that. So there may be a point where that happens. And check back here with both Cosmos site or Oregon UFO Research site to find out when that might happen as well.
Also, would like to let everyone know. Wonder where Jeff Rentz went. He went to 1550 KVAN AM radio. His program airs 10 p.m. to 1 a.m. Monday through Friday. That's the Jeff Rentz Sightings program. Mm-hmm. He's been on another station here in town for many, many years. And then, as with radio, things do change. Absolutely, things do change in this business, ladies and gentlemen. So we're very happy to inform you that the Jeff Rentz programs can be heard on KVAN 1550 AM, and that's way down right on your AM dial, so check him out.
Now, I know I speak for Cosmo, too, when I say that I can't tell you enough how important it is if you have a sighting, if you have something that you can't explain, something that's unusual or odd. Feel free to report it. There are so many people I know out there who have friends and family who have seen things they can't explain. Who've never reported it. I think all of us, if you talk at work or with your family, that somebody knows somebody who's had a sighting of something that they can't explain that they've just never really reported. So, you know, to get a good, accurate idea of what's going on in the state, please get on our website. Get on Cosmo's website or come to Oregon UFO Research's website at OregonUFOReview.com. There is a place there where you can fill out a report. Or you can just call the hotline number there, which is my home number. And, you know, most of the time we'll talk to you on the phone if you want to talk about it. If you just want to report it, and that'd be fine. Your name will be held back. We won't put it out there on the website if that's what you wish. So, please, we really encourage you to do this.
All right, great. Thanks a lot, Eric. Also, ladies and gentlemen, as we stated at the top of the hour, the OVNIs are back, Eric. They're back in Mexico again, and on Sunday, January 27, 2002, at 6:30 p.m., Mexican ufologist Pedro Hernandez videotaped a luminous UFO performing aerial maneuvers to the north and south of, can't even pronounce it, ladies and gentlemen, TLACOTEPEC, a suburb located about 40 kilometers, 25 miles west of Mexico City. According to Hernandez, UFO gave off a very intense light and flew at a very low altitude, as was also seen by the large portion of the valley's population. The video shows a peculiar object in the evening sky performing various maneuvers for 3 minutes at a great velocity. Frank, if we could just throw that Brenda Ruiz videotape in, I'd like to show that. And one of our past programs, ladies and gentlemen, a young lady called in. Eric was kind enough to find her, or they got in touch with her. I don't know how you did that one, but we've got a videotape. We showed it two shows back. We've gotten a lot of emails from you people out there saying you'd like to see it again. So we're going to show it full screen for you again. Then maybe Eric and I can talk over it, and we can discuss it and see what we've got here.
Okay.
Also, continuing with New Mexico while we cue that tape up. Later that evening, Hernandez observed several luminous objects passing across the sky at intervals of 5 minutes over the nearby town of Metapac. Okay, here we go. Oh, that's great. Look at that.
Yeah, this is the Ruiz tape. A little history on this. I was contacted by Ms. Ruiz the day before, and she did give permission, by the way, to use her name. The day before this actual video took place, and she reported that her son had come in from off of the patio and said, "Mom, could you come out here and look at this? There's something out here flying around." Well,
uh-huh.
She was used to her son coming in and showing her helicopters and airplanes and this and that. So she asked him, "Is this a helicopter or an airplane?" She said, "Well, I don't know." And so she went out and looked, and she saw this object that she refers to as sort of almost a silver sphere out there just kind of floating around and buzzing around the clouds. Well, she was mad at herself for not getting a video. She ran in to get her video camera, and when she returned, it had completely left the airspace. Very quickly from there, a couple of helicopters came from the nearby airport and flew into the airspace. It was thought that possibly these helicopters had scared off this particular object. There's a good steel frame
sure
right
is.
In between the trees there. The next day, she was very into wanting to watch the skies, which is really important if you're going to get a video.
No doubt.
Sure enough, it returned into the airspace the next day. She called me early in the day. She says, "Hey, I've got a video. She was very excited. I said, "Great, keep looking at the skies." By mid-afternoon, she had gotten a second video. Both of the videos are on here. One of the videos, like the one you just saw, is a little clearer than the other one, because the other one was much further away. And I think there's parts of this video where that our video guy tried to at least kind of circle it.
Daniel.
Yes, Daniel was
did a great
was a
job on
here.
That.
Exactly, he was a guest here on your show a while back. And so, it was a good sighting. It would have been nice if the video was a little clearer, but. You know, when you see something like that, get out the video and just do the best
hey,
you can.
Hey, when you're under the gun.
When you're under the gun, yeah. So.
But she did something about it.
She did, you know, and she, you know, considering her video camera was kind of dirty and her lens wasn't in that great of shape, at least she got out there and did the best she could, and that's all you can ask of anybody. Naturally, when you're watching it yourself and you're looking right at the object, it's a lot clearer than anything you can get on video. So, you know, a lot of what she described and what it looked like is based on her own description. And then a couple of good stills here that you see on the screen right now. It kind of, when you can get a spot where she's not moving the camera and the object, and like right in there where the object stays still, you can get kind of a feel for what she was looking at. She described the object as stopping, going, doing things that shouldn't have happened if it was just, say, a balloon floating around it. Yeah, it was a good sighting. We really appreciate her giving us that video and recording.
Very good. Thanks a lot, Eric. Ladies and gentlemen, that's Eric Beiler, one of our co-hosts for the Cosmic Connection. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have a sighting, if you have any news, if you have any videotape you'd like to supply us with here on the Cosmic Connection, just give us an email. Send us an email. Contact the Cosmic Connection. And that email address is ufotvshow@hotmail.com. Give out your information there, Eric.
Oregon UFO Research. You can see us on the internet at OregonUFOReview.com.
OregonUFOReview.com.
We have about 45 pages to go through there, as well as we have a recent sightings page that'll keep you updated on what's coming into us and what's coming into Peter Davenport at the National UFO Reporting Center in Seattle. We also have a past Oregon sightings page that will give you a good idea of some of the investigations that we've done as well. So it's an interesting read, a little UFO lore there to look through. And
okay, that's just going to about do it, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to close. Our next show for the Cosmic Connection is March 10th, 2002. Like to also let you know my director again, Frank, is up to some nasty business here. He's got some shows up. We've got Thursday, February 14th, midnight, Channel 11. Thursday, February 21st at 8:30 a.m., Channel 21. Wednesday, March 6th, 9 p.m., Channel 21, and that is Cops versus Goliath. This is a production that my director, Frank, has put together and has worked on, so you're going to want to check out Cop versus Goliath, and that's Thursday, February 14th, 12 midnight, Channel 11. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to thank again for your viewer participation. I'd like to thank my co-host today, Mr. Eric Byler, for coming all the way up here and battling the elements to get to the studio, to the secret underground studios of MCTV.
Thanks for having me.
Hey, it's our pleasure. And as always, ladies and gentlemen, look for more information we're going to be giving out. We're going to go out with Soren. Again, I'd like to thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to thank my friend Billy Goodman. Soren's going to take us out of here with Pluto's March. And I must say that I've got to thank Mr. Ross Bench for supplying us with our brand new intro, and for Mr. Shane Starinsky for supplying us with the music for our intro. We're going to go out with Soren. We'll see you in about a month. Pluto's March, ladies and gentlemen, for Eric Byler, Dennis, and myself, your host, the Cosmic Connector. We'll see you in 1 month. Good evening.
everything.